Simon & Schuster Audio presents Christine, a novel by Stephen King. Read by Holter Graham.
This is for George Romero and Chris Forrest Romero, and the Berg. Christine. Prologue. This is the story of a lover's triangle, I suppose you'd say. Arnie Cunningham, Leigh Cabot, and, of course, Christine. But I want you to understand that Christine was there first. She was Arnie's first love, and while I wouldn't presume to say for sure, not from whatever heights of wisdom I've attained in my 22 years anyway, I think she was his only true love. So I call what happened a tragedy. Arnie and I grew up on the same block together. Went to Owen Andrews Grammar School and Darby Junior High together, then to Libertyville High together. I guess I was the main reason Arnie didn't just get gobbled up in high school. I was a big guy there. Yeah, I know that doesn't mean donkey shit. 5 years after you've graduated, you can't even catch a free beer on having been captain of the football and baseball teams and an all-conference swimmer. But because I was, Arnie at least never got killed. He took a lot of abuse, but he never got killed. He was a loser, you know? Every high school has to have at least two. It's like a national law. One male, one female. Everyone's dumping ground. Having a bad day, flunked a big test, had an argument with your folks and got grounded for the weekend? No problem. Just find one of those poor, sad sacks that go scurrying around the halls like criminals before the homeroom bell and walk it right to him. And sometimes they do get killed. In every important way except the physical. Sometimes they find something to hold on to and they survive. Arnie had me. And then he had Christine. Leigh came later. I just wanted you to understand that. Arnie was a natural out. He was out with the jocks because he was scrawny, 5'10 and about 140 pounds soaking wet in all his clothes plus a pair of desert driver boots. He was out with the high school intellectuals, a pretty out-group themselves in a burg like Libertyville, because he had no specialty. Arnie was smart, but his brains didn't go naturally to any one thing, unless it was automotive mechanics. He was great at that stuff. When it came to cars, the kid was some kind of a goofy, born natural. But his parents, who both taught at the university in Horlicks, could not see their son, who had scored in the top 5% on his Stanford Binet, taking the shop courses. He was lucky they let him take Auto Shop 1, 2, and 3. He had to battle his butt off to get that. He was out with the druggies because he didn't do dope. He was out with the macho pegged jeans and Lucky Strikes group because he didn't do booze, and if you hit him hard enough, he'd cry. Oh, yes, and he was out with the girls. His glandular machinery had gone totally bananas. I mean, Arnie was Pimple City. He washed his face maybe 5 times a day, took maybe 2 dozen showers a week, and tried every cream and nostrum known to modern science. None of it did any good. Arnie's face looked like a loaded pizza, and he was going to have one of those pitted, poxy faces forever. I liked him just the same. He had a quirky sense of humor and a mind that never stopped asking questions, playing games and doing funky little calisthenics. It was Arnie who showed me how to make an ant farm when I was 7, and we spent just about one whole summer watching those little buggers, fascinated by their industry and their deadly seriousness. It was Arnie's suggestion when we were 10 that we sneak out one night and put a load of dried horse apples from the Route 17 stables under the gross plastic horse on the lawn of the Libertyville Motel just over the line in Monroeville. Arnie knew about chess first. He knew about poker first. He showed me how to maximize my Scrabble score. On rainy days, right up until the time I fell in love, well, sort of. She was a cheerleader with a fantastic body, and I sure was in love with that. Although when Arnie pointed out that her mind had all the depth and resonance of a Sean Cassidy 45, I couldn't really tell him he was full of shit, because he wasn't. It was Arnie I thought of first, because Arnie knew how to maximize rainy days, just like he knew how to maximize Scrabble scores. Maybe that's one of the ways you recognize really lonely people. They can always think of something neat to do on rainy days. You can always call them up. They're always home. Fucking always. For my part, I taught him how to swim. I worked out with him and got him to eat his green vegetables so he could build up that scrawny bod a little. I got him a job on a road crew the year before our senior year at Libertyville High, and for that one, we both battled our butts off with his parents, who saw themselves as great friends of the farm workers in California and the steel workers in the burg, but who were horrified at the idea of their gifted son, top 5% on his Stanford Binet, remember, getting his wrists dirty and his neck red. Then, near the end of that summer vacation, Arnie saw Christine for the first time and fell in love with her. I was with him that day. We were on our way home from work, and I would testify on the matter before the throne of Almighty God if called upon to do so. Brother, he fell, and he fell hard. It could have been funny if it hadn't been so sad, and if it hadn't gotten scary as quick as it did. It could have been funny if it hadn't been so bad. How bad was it? It was bad from the start, and it got worse in a hurry. Part 1. Dennis, Teenage Car Songs. Chapter 1. First Views. "Oh my God!" my friend Arnie Cunningham cried out suddenly. "What is it?" I asked. His eyes were bulging from behind his steel-rimmed glasses. He had plastered one hand over his face so that his palm was partially cupping his mouth, and his neck could have been on ball bearings the way he was craning back over his shoulder. "Stop the car, Dennis! Go back!" "What are you—" "Go back! I want to look at her again!" Suddenly, I understood. "Oh, man, forget it," I said. "If you mean that thing we just passed, go back!" He was almost screaming. I went back, thinking that it was maybe one of Arnie's subtle little jokes. But it wasn't. He was gone, lock, stock, and barrel. Arnie had fallen in love. She was a bad joke. And what Arnie saw in her that day, I'll never know. The left side of her windshield was a snarled spiderweb of cracks. The right rear deck was bashed in, and an ugly nest of rust had grown in the paint-scraped valley. The back bumper was askew, the trunk lid was ajar, and upholstery was bleeding out through several long tears in the seat covers, both front and back. It looked as if someone had worked on the upholstery with a knife. One tire was flat. The others were bald enough to show the canvas cording. Worst of all, there was a dark puddle of oil under the engine block. Arnie had fallen in love with a 1958 Plymouth Fury, one of the long ones with the big fins. There was an old and sun-faded for sale sign propped on the right side of the windshield, the side that was not cracked. "Look at her lines, Dennis," Arnie whispered. He was running around the car like a man possessed. His sweaty hair flew and flopped. He tried the back door on the passenger side, and it came open with a scream. "Arnie, you're having me on, aren't you?" I said. "It's sunstroke, right? Tell me it's sunstroke. I'll take you home and put you under the friggin' air conditioner, and we'll forget all about this, okay?" But I said it without much hope. He knew how to joke, but there was no joke on his face then. Instead, there was a kind of goofy madness I didn't like much. He didn't even bother to reply. A hot, stuffy billow of air, redolent of age, oil, and advanced decomposition, puffed out of the open door. Arnie didn't seem to notice that either. He got in and sat down on the ripped and faded back seat. Once, 20 years before, it had been red. Now it was a faded wash pink. I reached in and pulled up a little puff of upholstery, looked at it, and blew it away. "Looks like the Russian army marched over it on their way to Berlin," I said. He finally noticed I was still there.
"Yeah, yeah, but she could be fixed up. She could be tough. A moving unit, Dennis, a beauty, a real—"
Here, what are you two kids up to? It was an old guy, It looked as if he was enjoying, more or less, his 70th summer. Probably less. This particular dude struck me as the sort of man who enjoyed very little. His hair was long and scraggy, what little there was left of it. He had a good case of psoriasis going on the bald part of his skull. He was wearing green old man's pants and low-topped kids.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.